No, my hearty, my welcome tonight to Whanua Whina Plunkett's Eczema Chat. It's Skin Week and we are focusing on how to manage eczema. And tonight we have the wonderful Dr. Diana Purvis. Diana, tell us, what's your role?
I am a paediatric dermatologist, so that's a children's skin specialist, and I work at Starship Hospital here in Auckland.
Awesome. Wow, a wealth of knowledge then, and we're really, really lucky to have you. So thank you for coming on and having this chat with me. So called Maxine Aho. I've been a Plunkett nurse for years now and worked in different areas, and at the moment I'm at Plunkett Line. We're carrying on this evening from the live chat yesterday that is available on our Facebook page, the Whanua Whina Plunkett Facebook page. And that one was with Lydia Snell, who's a paediatric clinical nurse specialist, and she was discussing eczema and moisturizers. So to follow on, today we're going to talk about eczema and steroids. So steroids and moisturizers, they're a duo, they're a team, they come together. You need both to manage those flare-ups and manage long-term eczema, don't you, Diana?
You do. I think you have to remember the goal of eczema management is to try and restore as much as possible the natural skin barrier function. And I'm sure, I mean, Lydia may well have spoken about this. I haven't had a chance to watch her video. But we often think about the skin as being a wall that protects us from the outside. And when it's inflamed, it's like that wall's fallen down. Mm. And the moisturizer works like a paint on the outside. It's like your house maintenance. Really good. Yep. But if the house has fallen down too much, you can't just paint it. You need to rebuild it. And what steroids do is they treat that inflammation, calm the skin down so that it has a chance to heal up again. Yeah, so they work together, absolutely.
Awesome. So people, whanau out there, feel free to send us through any of your questions tonight. We'd love to put them to Dr. Diana and get some answers for you. But let's dive on into it. So look, let's start with the basics. What are steroids? What is a steroid?
Yeah, so we actually, our own bodies make steroids. They're compounds that act to reduce inflammation in the body. And the topical steroids are the steroid creams or ointments, sometimes lotions that we use for treating inflammation in the skin. And they come as a range of different products. They range in the strength of the steroid, or the potency is the medical term. And so for babies, which is Plunkett appropriate, we tend to use the very mildest potency. So this would be something like a 1% hydrocortisone would be the most commonly used product at that age. But there's stronger products which are appropriate for older people or for different conditions. But for babies and eczema, we tend to stay down in the shallow end. Because we don't tend to need the very strong products for babies.
Absolutely. So just want to touch on a word you use then, inflammation. And when we're thinking of inflammation, that's very different to our dry skin, isn't it? So our
it is a bit different. One of the really important things in working out if someone has eczema is whether it's itchy or not. And a lot of parents come and they say, how would I know if my baby is itchy or not, because they're only 3 months old? But as a parent, you will absolutely know if your child is itchy. You will see them when you're changing their nappy. They'll be grabbing at their tummy or grabbing at their thighs. They're lying on the bed. They'll be doing the wiggle to scratch their back, rubbing their face into you. And so... Yeah. Absolutely a parent will know if their child is itchy. And there are some conditions that look a little bit like eczema, which aren't eczema, and they're not itchy. And so those things are like a little bit of dry skin that can be managed with moisturizer, doesn't have inflammation to cause itch. And the other common one that often gets mistaken for eczema is something called seborrheic dermatitis, which is related to the cradle cap babies often get. And with seborrheic dermatitis, you'll see the babies with the bright red, weepy skin and the folds of the neck or in the arms. And the babies are happy as Larry. They're not itchy. And so that doesn't need to be treated as much as an eczema with steroids. And mainly you can manage that with moisturizer.
Right. So we've just, that's really good timing. We've just had a question come through from a mama or in through Facebook. So saying, my 8-month-old son suffered from scalp infection plus eczema 2 months ago. The scalp seems clear at the moment, just a bit of cradle cap, but he still can't stop scratching his head. What cream would you recommend?
Yeah, so there's a few... I think there's a few things that are worth unpicking in that question. Obviously, I can't see the baby to examine them, but a lot of babies will scratch and pull at their head as a settling behaviour when they're going off to sleep. That's a really common soothing thing. The babies will lie in their crib and they'll pull with their hair and that. And so if it's just that self-settling kind of playing, then you don't need to treat that with eczema treatment. But if the skin is itchy all the time, and particularly it might look red, or if you've got skin of colour, you can't always see the redness, it might just look darker, then that would suggest that there's more going on and that there is eczema inflammation there. And so if it's you've not treated with anything at all before, I don't think it would be unreasonable to start just with a plain moisturizer and to use that for a few days. And for some eczema, that's, if it's mild, that will be sufficient to settle it down and to get the skin to heal up. But if the itching is more intense, then even on the scalp, it is quite safe to use steroids on the scalp. People worry because it's near the face or on the head, but it's actually the skin on the scalp is very tough and it's okay to use steroids on there.
Yeah. Absolutely. And so I guess it's about going back to the GP if, hey, you've done the treatment from 2 months ago and that's cleared up the really gnarly infection at the start, but hey, bub's still quite itchy. So if they've still got that level of irritation going on, then probably need to go back and review the treatment.
Yeah, I think that's really important, the idea that it's a changing thing. Eczema often changes, and babies change a lot as they grow and develop as well. So it's quite reasonable to go back and seek more advice if things have changed.
Yeah, absolutely. And we were discussing that before, weren't we, about how, when we get the first signs of eczema or when eczema first develops for our PEPI, for our children, and you may not have eczema yourself, you may never have dealt with it before, it is a massive learning curve, like a really big learning curve to try and figure out and work out what works for your child. And so, like you're saying there, being able to go back and go back until you feel comfortable that, yep, what you're doing is working, and keeping that line of communication and that plan active with your GP is a really important tool in the eczema kitty, isn't it? Cool. So I suppose we've had a talk about what steroids are. And we've talked about why we use them to get rid of that itch and to allow the skin to build itself up again from the inside. So how do we go about using it? How do we go about using steroids and when would we use them?
Yeah, so that's a big question.
Okay, let's unpack it.
Okay. So I think... there's some important things in terms of recognizing which skin has eczema and which skin needs treatment. And I think it's really important when I see a child with eczema, that touch and that feel of the skin is really important in assessing the skin. Often it will look red or darker brown, or sometimes it will look a bit pale, but it will feel rough and it will often have scratch marks on it. And I quite commonly seek to get on top of their child's eczema because they're focusing their treatment just on the very worst parts of the body. And so that my skin's really bad around the ankles and at the knees And so they've just been putting the steroid cream on there, but they've been ignoring the fact that there's rough, inflamed skin all over the child's tummy and back. Mm. And when you have inflammation of eczema, I think of it a little bit like a fire, like a forest fire. And when you're fighting a forest fire, it's really important to put the whole fire out. You can't just put your hose on the bits where the flames are the highest and think everything's going to go away. You have to put the whole fire out. And the reason we need to do that in eczema is that under the skin, there's inflammatory cells that send out little signals. And these stir up inflammation elsewhere in the body. And so if you don't turn off all of the eczema, you end up just chasing it around, or it's coming back all the time, and it's quite frustrating. Mm. And so I recommend that parents put the steroid cream over all of the areas of the body that have eczema. And for some babies, this will be just about their whole body, usually not under the nappy. It's very unusual to get eczema under the nappy. And so, but sometimes it can be all over the body and down the arms and the legs. It's a big area to put steroid cream in, and people are a bit nervous about doing that. And so I find it's quite helpful to mix it a little bit with their moisturizer. So that means you don't have to use as much of the steroid cream, but you can get that coverage over the whole body. And it works just as well if you do it like that. But you really need to turn that whole inflammation off. And in terms of how often do you put it on, I usually get people to put steroids on just once a day. You don't need to put it on 3-4 times a day. It doesn't give it any extra benefit. So just once a day after the bath, alongside the time that you put the moisturizer on, is a really good way to do it. Yeah.
Awesome. Mm. Sorry, carry on, Diana.
If a steroid is working for you, you should see improvement in the skin. And usually, sometimes that's just in a few days, it will look a lot better. Sometimes it might take a week or so. If you've been putting the steroid cream on every day for 2 weeks and it's not improving significantly, it's probably not the right treatment for your baby, and you need to go back and get it checked over. So there might be that there's some other problem that's meaning it's not working. Might be that they don't have eczema after all, or that you've got the wrong cream, or they've got an infection that needs to be treated. But there's something else going on. It should work quite effectively and quite quickly.
Yeah.
The other thing that parents often come in and report is that they used the steroid cream and it got better, but they stopped it and it all came back again a couple of days later. It looks like you've experienced that.
Yeah, definitely.
And I guess I think that's where it's really important to understand what's happening with inflammation in the skin. That's when those little cells under the microscope in the skin are sending off these little inflammatory proteins. And it's like when you put the steroid on, you calm them down, but they don't go away immediately. And so under the microscope, although the skin might look better to the naked eye, under the microscope, it often takes 4 or 6 weeks, sometimes even longer, to really get better. And so eczema is a long-term, it's a chronic condition. So we need to manage it long-term. And I think the problem we have with steroids is that they're not designed to be used every day long-term. But we can use them quite safely, and there's quite a lot of research that shows we can use them quite safely for 3, 6, 12 months if we're using them just a couple of times a week. And so what I often get people to do is to use the steroid cream every day till they've brought it under control, and then maybe hit the bits that are the worst bits, often around the joints. Just manage those by treating it preventively or proactively just a couple of times a week.
That is really good advice, and actually helps to clear up some of the sort of, you know, like when and how and what's the risk of using steroids, because that's another question we often get is, are they safe to use?
I think, parents want to do the best for their children. their health providers want to do their best for their children as well. And so we're all trying to manage the baby safely. With the very mild steroids like hydrocortisone, it's incredibly difficult to get side effects from them in babies. It's extremely uncommon. I see many more babies who are seriously unwell or admitted to hospital who have not been using steroids for their eczema. We don't see babies coming in with side effects from steroid creams. The ones that people often worry about, particularly they worry about skin thinning. And there's quite good evidence. They've done studies where they've followed up children with eczema being treated with steroids that are much stronger than the ones we tend to use in small babies, following them up for 6 and 12 months and have not shown that to cause any skin thinning in children. Skin thinning is a little bit more of a problem in adults, but we won't talk about adults here because they're too old.
No, and that's really helpful to know that you can use it for a week or two, as you said.
In 2 weeks, and then use it, but just less frequently. So those days off are what makes it really important in terms of safety. Yeah. So I don't want to see people using hydrocortisone every day for 3 or 6 months. That's not appropriate. But to use it for 1 or 2 weeks and then to drop back to using it a couple of times a week is quite safe, and you shouldn't cause any problems with that frequency.
So it's about using it for that 2 weeks to really put out the forest fire.
Put out the fire, and then you have to spray the hose over the embers to stop the fire from
every couple of days, just to cool it off. Yeah. I like that. That's a good analogy. Yeah, that's really good. Yeah. So we've had some further questions come through. Thank you, whānau, on the Facebook chat. So one says, my 8-month-old has eczema on her eyelids, not itchy, just light red, and patch in the middle of her forehead. So when we're thinking about the skin in those areas, they are quite thin, quite sensitive areas, aren't they? So what would you want to talk on with that sort of question?
Again, I do wonder whether it really is eczema, because she's saying it's not itchy. And I'm sure you'll know a lot of babies do have little red birthmarks that they get on their eyelids and in the middle of their forehead. Angel's kiss, we call them. and they are not a form of eczema. The skin will feel nice and smooth. It won't be scaly and rough. And those birthmarks just fade away by themselves over the first couple of years. If it was eczema, I'd expect it to be itchy. And an 8-month-old is really good at scratching if they'd
be going like that.
Would be going like that. And also the skin would, if you ran your fingers over it, you would feel the skin was rough and you might feel flaky, dry skin on it. And so if you were going to treat those areas, we do have to be a bit more cautious about using things within the eye socket, because the eye is quite sensitive to steroids. Again, the very mild steroids, like the 1% hydrocortisone, are what we would prefer to use in that area. But again, I would probably start with a plain moisturizer again as my first thing. And often for eyelids, I often use plain Vaseline, which is really greasy, and that can work quite well. But if that doesn't work, yes, you can use a bit of hydrocortisone there, but you would want to be a bit more cautious about how often you are using that. And so for this baby where we're not sure, I would suggest it might be worth them going to get it checked with their GP or their practice nurse about what actually is happening there.
So getting that diagnosis, then having that discussion with your GP about what you're dealing with and how to deal with it, and then come away with the correct cream or treatment.
Because if this is a little stalk mark, a little birthmark that's going to go away by itself, putting steroid creams is not going to fix it. And so you may get in a situation where somebody would keep putting the steroid cream thinking that they wasn't working. And the reason it won't work is because it's not the right treatment for that
diagnosis. That's right. And you can, and like you said, you know, starting off with this, if you're not sure if it is eczema and you're just starting off, you know, waiting to get in and see the GP, maybe just using a really basic moisturiser or a Vaseline just to see if that really has an effect.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's a lot of moisturisers out there that are on prescription. that you can get prescribed by your GP or your practice nurse can often prescribe them for you. They're very plain, and that's quite good. We don't like to use a lot of fancy stuff on babies. We don't like a lot of perfume and fragrances. Keep it really simple. And staying away from the bubble baths and the soaps and the washes, just keep it really simple when looking after baby skin.
Cool. Yeah, that's really good advice, eh? Because the other thing to do with that is you don't know what's working if you're using all these different things. So it's kind of good just to, you know, stick with what's been advised by your GP until you figure it out. So another couple of questions here. So one of them talking around pintasol in the bath. I guess the thing there is it's not steroids. However, pintasol, and it says here that your baby does not have inflammation, so but it's itchy and dry. So what would you recommend around the use of pintasol? Because that can dry the skin out a bit, can't it?
It can a bit, actually. Pintasol's got an anti-inflammatory in it, which is a form of coal tar, and it gives it that special fragrance. If you've ever used it, it's got quite a specific smell.
It's very strong.
I tend not to use it a lot for patients with eczema because I do find it tends to dry their skin out. And I think for this baby, then probably be better just with a plain water bath and maybe some sorbeline as a moisturizer or something like that as a soap substitute. Mm-hmm. And perhaps put the pine tarsol to one side.
And then see if that calms down that itchiness and dryness, eh?
Yeah, because they actually, if they are itchy, they probably are a bit inflamed. Even if it doesn't look red, it may still be a bit inflamed and need some treatment. But that might just be a moisturiser on its own. But if it's not settling with that, it might need some steroid cream.
Yeah, so again, good to have that discussion with your GP. But, yeah, if you're feeling like the skin's really drying out, pine tarsol might, like you said, be good to put aside. And there's another question here around stopping the use of steroids. And what would your advice be if whānau are looking to do that or they've been advised to do that? Is there kind of any sort of weaning process or can you just stop the use?
Yeah, it's I think people, there's a lot of opinions out there about steroids, and a lot of people do get quite uncertain about continuing to use them. I want to try stopping them for their babies. I do think that steroids are a really important part of our eczema management, and I think they can be used very safely and effectively. And as I said, the babies we see who come in very sick with eczema into hospital, either they've got a skin infection, which can happen to anybody if you're unlucky, or that we've had some babies in where the parents have chosen not to use any active medical treatment for their baby's skin, and the babies have become quite severely dehydrated and lost a lot of weight because their skin is so inflamed. So I think steroids, I know people would prefer not to use any medication for a baby, but unfortunately when you have a medical condition, sometimes you do need to use something.
So basically, I mean the use of steroids is safe when it's used as advised, and there is no need to withdraw from it if they are useful for you and you are needing them for your skin to stay well.
Yes, I think I see that there's a question about something called topical steroid withdrawal syndrome, and this is something that is a recognised phenomenon in adults. And we tend to see that in people who've been using super potent steroids, which we don't tend to use in children, and been putting it on, usually it's on the face that we see it, and they've often been using steroid creams every day for years and years and years. Yeah. And it is a very difficult condition to manage. It's not something that we generally would see in children. Usually the problem we have in children where the steroids have been stopped is that their eczema just flares out of control, and then we have a lot of difficulty with managing that rather than the steroid withdrawal syndrome.
That's right. So what would what would some of the good sort of basic moisturizers that you were mentioning before, what would be some of the main ones that you would recommend? There's a bunch of different products out there, but
there's a heap of products. You could spend a small fortune buying products for eczema. It's really interesting. There was just a publication. They did a research study looking at parents using different types of moisturizer for their children's eczema. And they used ointments, they used creams, all sorts of different ones. This was set in the UK, so a lot of their products weren't exactly the same as we have here. But essentially, they found that it didn't matter what you used, as long as you put something on and that it didn't sting or irritate your child's skin. And so I'm very happy with people using products that they can buy at the pharmacy, and there's a whole lot of different ones which are marketed for eczema. Some of them feel beautiful and they have pretty pumps and they're lovely, but actually I get just as good results with the prescription products. And I know most families with small children are on a tight budget, and your prescription moisturizers that you get from your GP or your primary healthcare provider, that will be funded and that's free for your baby. And so I don't think that's a good you don't need to spend a lot of money on that to get good products for your child.
Yeah, that's really, really good point. So, you know, and going back to what you said before about making sure that we're not using things that are full of fragrances and additives, we're keeping it really basic. And that stuff we're going to get from the GP, whether it be sorbolene or emulsifier or whatever, it's going to be funded. It's cheap. It's free for baby. And it's going to be a very basic moisturizing agent, isn't it? It's not going to be a bunch of stuff that's likely to irritate their skin. Some of the store-bought stuff can be, like you said, really nice, but not necessary. So don't feel like you have to go and get those really pricey, flashy ones to treat your little one's eczema. Cool. So so there's some questions around seeing at when, how you can access appointments for getting skin tests done with little ones.
I think one of the things that parents always ask about is, what is it that I'm eating that's going through my breast milk, or what am I feeding my baby that's causing the eczema? And people ask that all the time. It's a tricky issue, because the challenge we have is that eczema and food allergy go a little bit together in the same people, just like eczema and asthma are seen more commonly in the same people. In the past, people were really concerned that the food allergy was causing the eczema, but actually we've found through research that having eczema predisposes people to having food allergies. And what we do know is that taking the food out of children's diet doesn't make a big deal of difference to their eczema, but it does carry a lot of risks with it in terms of losing the tolerance of those foods, and also nutritional issues and nutritional deficiencies. And so generally for food, we recommend that all mothers eat a normal diet while they're pregnant, that you eat a normal diet while you're breastfeeding, and we would encourage people, if you want to protect your baby against allergies and eczema and asthma, that breastfeeding is really helpful if you can. But if you can't, that's okay still. Introducing your solid foods quite early is helpful, and there's quite a lot of evidence showing that introducing foods early helps prevent the development of food allergies. But they won't, taking foods out, individual foods out, does not help make the eczema better. And so I do a lot of clinics with the allergists at Starship, And the really around that, we're trying to keep the diet as normal as we can, as long as the children aren't having anaphylactic type reactions to foods. And that's a different kind of reaction to eczema. It's a quite an immediate reaction, usually within half an hour to an hour of eating the food. So that's right. A different thing. So if it's that you eat something and your eczema is a bit worse 2 days later, you're better to keep that food in your diet. It's really important.
Rather than cut it out.
Yeah.
So that you keep your system, so that keep your little one's system is still being using it.
So, like, I mean, a lot of people will come and say, but my child seems to get worse after the eats. But you've got to play the long game. You want them to go to school eating as normal a diet as they possibly can. And if you have to use a little more creaming to keep the eczema under control, that's worth it if they tolerate that food long term. If you stop foods, and I have had children who have, for whatever reason, they've been tolerating peanuts and then they've been told to stop them because they have eczema. And they've stopped them for as little as a month. And then when they reintroduced them, they suddenly had anaphylaxis to it. And they're then not able to eat peanut for the rest of their life, you know. So it's really important you try and keep that diet as normal as possible.
That's really interesting. And so I guess, you know, when you're worried about, you know, allergies and eczema, regardless of what's causing what, you know, if you're wanting to access the services in the hospital, so, you know, the specialist like yourself, how would you go about doing that?
Yeah, well, it depends where you live, really. I think probably in most parts of New Zealand, eczema and allergy care, there's some GPs who have special interest in it, and so you might want to do some local research if there's a GP that has an interest in that. Certainly if things are more complex, then they would usually, these children would usually get seen through paediatric departments, and there's a lot of general paediatricians who can assess for food allergy and are very good at managing eczema. Here at, I work at Starship Hospital, and so we just tend to see the very complicated patients mostly where I work. So it's a filter through to me.
That's right. But that's, you know, it's good to know that that's the, you know, that's how you go about accessing the services, you know, in the, what we used to call the DHBs, but in the hospital services now, I suppose you would go through your GP. And if you're really not able to manage it in that community setting, then it is, you know, getting your, or having that discussion with your GP around being referred on to the specialists in the hospital and waiting for that appointment.
Yeah, and I think I think you had Lydia Snell talking yesterday, and
yesterday,
she's a nurse specialist, you know, and there's quite a few nurses who have a special interest in eczema and food allergies around the country, and they can be an amazing resource for families, for education and support. So it's a little bit of where you are and who's available, but there's some really awesome people out there. So your primary care provider, your GP or your well child provider can help point you in the right direction.
So I guess, you know, coming back to the topic at hand around steroids and that sort of focus, what would be your key messaging that you wanted to put out there to whānau who are just having to juggle it and not quite sure of how, what, when to use steroids? What would be your key takeaway message for them?
So I think it's important to get to recognise what eczema is like in your child's skin and what it feels like and what it looks like. So it'll feel rough, might look red or darker brown, and it will be itchy. And that needs to be treated, and all of it needs to be treated. We're putting out the forest fire here.
Yes, that's right.
And you should expect your steroid cream to work quite quickly. It should work in a few days, maximum 2 weeks, to get the skin much improved. You might then need to taper it away, but you shouldn't have to keep using it every day longer than that. And if you are, then you need to get reviewed. But in a longer term pattern, it's quite safe to continue to use steroids creams a couple of times a week to fight the little hot spots that pop up.
Put out the embers.
And so that can be quite a safe way to manage it. But I think I guess I want to make people to feel comfortable to use steroids. I think they're really important. They're really effective. They're probably the best treatment we have for eczema. And that if you use them, that they can work really well and they can really make your child so much more comfortable and happy.
Yeah, and that's what we're wanting in the end, is for our little one to, you know, be able to function and do all the things they want to do and have fun and enjoy their well-being and just, grow and with, you know, without having to experience that all the time. And, you know, having a little one with eczema is a really common thing here in New Zealand, eh? So it's not, you're not alone. You can always get in touch with, like we said, your GP, some really awesome and useful information online. You can call Plunkett Line 24/7 if you want to have that discussion. What would be some of your best resources that you would refer whānau to?
So there's some really good resources on kids' health. There's some great information and there's some videos. The other resource that's quite good for people who are wondering about introducing solid foods for their baby is the ASCIA website. So ASCIA stands for Australasian Society of Clinical Immunology and Allergy. So they're the specialists in Australasia in food allergies, essentially.
Right.
And they have a really nice website. It's called NIP Allergies in the Bub, B-U-B. And that has advice on how to introduce solid foods, particularly for children who are a little bit more at risk of food allergies, so kids with bad eczema, kids where there's a family history. And so giving parents the confidence to know how to introduce solids quite safely to really optimize the chance that their baby won't have a food allergy. That's a really useful one too.
Cool, that's really good. Maybe we can get those links up on our website, would be really good, or even in the link to this Facebook live chat. So we will also have this live chat available and on the website if anybody wants to go back and watch it from the start, especially if you just joined us towards the end. And we'll also have it on our Whanau Awhina Plunkett YouTube show as well. So anything else you wanted to touch on before you leave us tonight, Diana?
I don't know. I think we've probably talked about most things for steroids, eh?
Yeah, we did. We got through most of it. And it is a big topic. It's a really big topic. But it's been wonderful, wonderful talking to you tonight. Thank you so much for joining us and giving us your knowledge and advice. It's been really, really great.
Well, thank you. It's my pleasure. It's lovely to be here.
Wonderful, Diana. So to the whānau out there, thank you all for watching. That was wonderful. I'd like to invite you to come and watch our next Facebook live chat, which is on Thursday evening from 7 p.m. as well. And this one's going to be around bathing and beach bleach. Baths, try and say that 10 times, with Whaasoa Aupaua at another paediatric clinical nurse specialist. Mm-hmm. So aren't we lucky with all this wealth of knowledge coming our way? Awesome. Well, look, thank you very much, Diana. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Maxine.
Cool. Ka kite.